Well, good afternoon, everyone. Oh, I sound very loud. Not used to that. Okay, so we have a couple of hours of VAT. There are now just 16 days left to VAT being introduced. Can I maybe just start with a show of hands? How many of you already are quite familiar with VAT? Just a show of hands. Okay, so there's a couple. How many of you are already registered for VAT? Okay, a couple more, that's quite good. And how many of you feel confident on VAT? Okay, that one was maybe a bit of a trick question. That was a bit of a trick question. Okay, so what are we going to cover this afternoon? I think, first of all, we'll cover the key objectives. So we'll explain a bit more about what we intend to do, what I would like you to be able to take away from this session today. And then, why is it important to understand VAT? What's the impact on your business? What is it actually going to do? And then we'll do a session on kind of decoding VAT and trying to make it a bit more relevant so that you can then understand it better. And then the final short session is a kind of series of particular supply chain maps in order to demonstrate what the current the specific treatment will be for various different supply chains. Okay, so far so good. All right, so the objectives of the session. So I think the first one and the obvious one is to raise VAT awareness. Okay? The second one is for you to understand the potential impacts of VAT on your business. And there's always a little bit of us is quite personal, so what's also the implications of VAT for us as individuals? Then what's the VAT implication for DMCC businesses? And a bit of a guide to help you get ready for VAT. Okay? Now there's not one specific section covering a guide to get ready for VAT because the whole thing will give you that guide. So you have to take it in totality. Okay? All right, so why is VAT important? Well, I think the first thing is to recognise, and even before I go into the slides, the first thing to recognise is that if you don't get your VAT right, then there are a number of consequences for not getting VAT right. And maybe if we start on those, and then I'll go on and explain what VAT is. So if you get your VAT wrong, the first thing is that you might not be charging VAT when perhaps you should be. So if you're not charging it, you're not getting paid it. And if you're not getting paid the VAT you're entitled to, then that's going to cost you money. Okay? If you don't understand the VAT that you incur and how much of that you can reclaim, if any, then again, that's going to cost you money. And ultimately, if you get your VAT wrong, if you have an error in VAT, if you maybe haven't registered at the right time, or if you have a document from a VAT perspective that is wrong, then actually what that means is that you could end up with a penalty from the Federal Tax Authority as well. So actually the cost of getting VAT wrong can be quite a high financial cost. And that's not to scare you, it's just that's the realistic position, and it's helpful to know that, and then we can then apply VAT principles to what each of us does in order to get to the right answer at the end. So aside from the cost of VAT, there are some other implications of getting VAT wrong, and this kind of lends itself to why it's important. So if you get your VAT wrong, well, there could also be some reputational risks, and there could be some commercial risks. Because if you're sitting in that supply chain and you're the one that's got it wrong, then that can be a difficult place to be. So for all of those reasons, and just out of general interest, then I'm sure you can appreciate why VAT is important. So the key thing with VAT is it's a transaction tax. Now what that means is that every single time there is a transaction, there will be a VAT consequence. Okay, so every time you buy something, every time you sell it, if you just lend it, if you borrow it, if you gift it to someone, if you receive a payment, if the payment you receive isn't in cash but is in kind, all of these things will have a VAT outcome. So all of those are transactions from a VAT perspective. And there are also something called deemed transactions or deemed supplies. And they are supplies that are not actual supplies. So there are some things that we just pretend are supplies from a VAT perspective in order to make sure that VAT is accounted for. Okay, so when you think of VAT, every time you think of doing something, there will be a VAT outcome. Okay, so the risks of not getting VAT right. So we talked about not identifying the impact. We talked about underpaying your VAT. Inevitably, there will be some VAT costs. There can be penalties. And the FTA have been quite clear and are being quite forceful in their current view that penalties will apply from day one. There's a reputational risk. And then sometimes there's also that risk and the potential damage to commercial relationships if you've got that wrong. So the purpose of this session is to help you understand how VAT actually works. What I will do is I'll also make it as practical as possible. Okay, so there's the information on the slides, but what I'll also do is talk you through the practical implications and what might help you to get it actually embedded into your business, given that there is such a relatively short time scale left. And part of that is also how do you know to make informed decisions from a VAT perspective? Which decisions should you make if you're buying goods from someone who's registered and someone who's not registered? Who gives you the better deal, for example? So we can talk about things like that. And then actually better understand what is your business's VAT position. Okay, so there were quite a lot of hands up saying that they're registered for VAT, but actually no one was confident in VAT. And actually very few, so more hands have registered than those who are even familiar. So this session is really nicely timed to help you get that familiarity with VAT. But the other thing I would say about VAT is that it's really important that everyone in, you know, whether you're a single person in the business or whether there are multiple people in your business, actually the thing with VAT is that everyone can get involved. Okay, because it does kind of creep across various different component parts in a business. So where are we today with VAT? Well, if we take it back to almost a year ago, the Federal Tax Authority was introduced in the UAE on the 1st of January 2017. So it's about to have its first birthday party. And they're going to celebrate with their first birthday party by launching VAT. All right? So the rest of us might not celebrate, but I think the FTA will with their first anniversary. The VAT law was introduced on the 28th of August. But actually, although that gave some information, what it didn't do was give a lot of the detail that you need in order to actively apply VAT. And that came on the 28th of November with the executive regulations. Now, many of you are already registered, and the VAT portal to allow you to register opened at the beginning of October. So there is still time. We'll cover registrations in a little while, but there is still time to register if you do so quickly. But one of the other things in terms of VAT is that it's actually based on the European model. So how many of you are familiar with European VAT? Okay, so there's a few. So the principles that you would be used to from a European perspective will be exactly the same principles that are applied here. But always remember, this is a different law, it's a different country, so some of the things will be different, but the general principles you could reasonably rely on. And then the other thing is to recognise that the UAE sits within the GCC. Okay, so there are a series of six member states that form the GCC. And all of those member states collectively have decided that they will implement VAT. Now, not all of them are going to implement VAT from the 1st of January. So we know, for example, that Saudi intend to implement VAT from the 1st of January. So we will have two states implementing from the 1st of January. But we also know that for all of the other member states, it will be sometime either later in 2018, or perhaps early 2019, because the others aren't as well advanced either in their legislation or in their thinking about VAT. Now, one of the key things in the agreement across the GCC is that The GCC agreement itself is not law, but what it does do is it sets out the principles and the understanding across the different member states as to what they can do to implement VAT and where those objectives and principles sit. Now, part of that means that, for example, they have optional VAT treatment for things like education, for health, for government sector, for real estate, for oil and gas, and finally for financial services. So the framework itself allows the individual member states to make a decision on how they will treat. So the framework agreement is useful, but then you have to read each individual legislation because they will all be subtly different. Okay, so a bit about the structure of VAT. So the first thing is we talked about it being a transaction tax, but actually it's also a consumption tax. Now, as a consumption tax, what that means is that every single one of us in this room will pay VAT to a greater or lesser extent, depending on what you buy and what your normal activities would be. But each of us will ultimately pay VAT. As individuals, that's what we do. We're the ones that consume the services. We're the ones that consume the goods. And therefore, we're the ones that foot the VAT bill. Now, the interesting thing about VAT, particularly in the UAE, because it's one of the first taxes, we know the excise tax was introduced recently, but VAT was the first tax to be recognised as to be implemented in the UAE. And the reason it's a really clever tax to implement is if you look at VAT across the world, it's like a rash. It started in a few member states in Europe, and it's now actually just grown across the world. But the reason it is so easy to implement is that as a government, the government doesn't have to do very much from a VAT perspective. All the government needs to do is give you some rules. Okay, VAT is a self-assessing tax. So what that means is that all of the responsibility to get VAT right is with you. All the government does is give you the rules and tells you how to do it. They expect you to make your own judgments. They expect you to do the registration. You have to complete and submit your returns. You have to make sure your documentation's right, and you have to ultimately make sure that your payments are right too. So the accounting and the requirements in VAT very heavily sit on business. So it's actually a very low cost tax for the government to implement. But it does mean you have the increased administration. So it's also known as goods and services tax. Now, GST, as it's sometimes shortened, can also mean something else, because it can mean a general sales tax, which is what the US have. And VAT is not a general sales tax. It is a full goods and services tax. And the reason that's different is, as a goods and services tax, it covers everything, not just a sale. So you do have to think about it. If you buy something, you do have to think about it for all the other transactions that we suggested earlier. The other thing is, if you're importing goods, so if you're bringing goods into the UAE or if you're trading them, then there will be a VAT consequence of those as well. So you have to think about that too. Now, we do know about the rate of tax. So I mentioned that VAT is typically in about 167 countries across the world. The highest rate of tax, actually, I'm going to ask a question here. Does anyone want to suggest what the highest rate of VAT is across the world? 20? 21? Okay, I'm going to play a card game here. Higher, higher? Oh, okay, 27 I heard. 27 until June was the highest rate of VAT, and that was in Hungary. But it's now been beaten by one other country. 40. Not quite. It's India. It is, you got the country right, it is India, but it's actually 28%. So when you compare 28% VAT or 27% VAT, and then you realise that in the UAE or across the GCC, we're going to implement VAT at a rate of 5%, then it's actually the lowest rate in the world. So although it has a huge impact on us as individuals and on businesses across the UAE and the GCC, at a rate of 5%, it's the lowest in the world. Okay. There is also a zero rate for a selected number of goods, and I'll go on and talk about them in a few minutes. Okay, so what is VAT? So we said it was a consumption tax, We also said that it was on all transactions, including imports, and it's a transaction tax. So each and every time there is a supply, VAT will apply. So what that means is if you buy something from one person, they will apply VAT. When you sell it on to another party, there will be VAT on that. When that party then sells it on to someone else, there will be VAT, and so on and so forth until it reaches the final consumer. So VAT is every single step in that supply chain. Only a business that is registered, yeah? Only a business that is registered for VAT is entitled to charge VAT. So if you're not registered, you're not allowed to charge VAT. But that also means that you're not entitled to recover VAT. Okay, so that means that it could be a cost to you. We talked about being borne by the final consumer, but as a business, VAT shouldn't be a cost because you're entitled to get the VAT back on your sale, on your purchases. But we recognise that there, although there might not be a financial cost, there will be, for example, an administrative cost, because you still have to, you have to keep your books and records. You're going to have to complete and submit VAT returns. There may also be a cash flow cost. So being practical about it, you might have to pay your supplier before your customer pays you the VAT that's due. You might end up with some bad debts. You might end up not getting paid for a very long time. You might end up in a position where you're entitled to get a refund from the tax authority. But that refund might be delayed by how long, we don't know. So there will be cash flow implications as well when it comes to VAT. And the reality is there are lots of, although VAT is designed to be a simple tax, there are actually a lot of complexities and exceptions to the general rules. Okay, so we talk about supplies from a VAT perspective. So what is a supply? What are the conditions that have to be there in order for a supply to exist? And this is what they are. So first of all, you have to have a supply of goods or services. You have to be doing something. Okay, you have to be selling something or presenting something. That supply has to happen in the UAE. If it happens, I'm from Scotland, if it happens in Scotland, it's irrelevant. So it actually has to happen in the UAE. Doesn't matter if it happens in India or China or Australia, it has to happen in the UAE. And there are rules, there are VAT rules in the law that tells you what the place of supply will be. It also has to be for consideration. Now, 9 times out of 10, when it talks about consideration, it'll mean hard cash. You expect to get paid if you're providing something, okay? That's fair. If you're providing a service or you're providing someone with goods, you expect to get paid in return. And 9 times out of 10, that payment will be in cash. But the phrase for consideration doesn't mean for cash, because you might also do a trade. You might say, well, I will do this for you if you do that for me. I will give you this, you give me that. And actually, it's just a barter transaction. So you're still getting something out of the transaction, even if it's not cash. It also has to be by a person. But the key point here is it has to be in the course of business. So if it's a hobby or just something that you're playing at, it's not a business supply, therefore not subject to VAT. Okay, so that's the basic conditions of what a supply would look like. Now, there are various types of supplies. And you will quite often hear people talk about taxable supplies. The rate of VAT is 5%. That's the standard rate across the GCC. Okay? But there is also another supply, which is also subject to tax, which is 0%. And these two are really important, because if you make a supply that's either subject to VAT at 5 or 0, then guess what? You get to get all your VAT back. That's a good thing. However, there are also other types of supplies. So there is a supply that's termed exempt. And as a VAT professional, one of the biggest frustrations I have with the press is that, apart from the misconception about VAT and the kind of rogue rules that they put out, is the fact that they frequently talk about zero rating and VAT exempt as if it's the same thing. So as I'm about to demonstrate, they are worlds apart. If you make a zero-rated supply, you still charge VAT, but it's 0%. So the effect is that the other person isn't paying extra VAT. But if your supply happens to be VAT exempt, then you're not allowed to charge VAT. So if you're not allowed to charge VAT onto the supply that you're making, that actually also means, guess what? You cannot claim back the VAT on your costs. So there is a huge difference between zero rating and exemption. And it's an important distinction to make as we go through and work out what the VAT consequences would be. Okay, so if I start from the right-hand side, so the key thing here is that everything, every supply in the UAE is subject to VAT at 5%, unless, this is the way the legislation is written, everything is subject to VAT at 5%, unless it is specifically zero rated or it is specifically exempt in the legislation. Okay, so if it doesn't fall under the zero rating or exempt, then you know that it's going to be plus VAT at 5. So let's take a look at what's zero rated. So if you're exporting goods, if you're sending goods outside the UAE, you wouldn't expect to charge VAT on them. Okay, and that keeps competition alive and international trade healthy. International transportation and the ancillary services that go with international transportation, again, zero rated. So you don't want to increase your cost when you're selling goods outside. You want to be able to effectively trade in the international market. If you charge VAT on it, you wouldn't be able to. So that's all zero rated. They also talk about specific sea, air and land means of transport. This is a phrase from the legislation. Basically what it means is a ship and an aircraft. Or a train, something that's done that has a size. We know that precious metals are zero rated. So pure gold will be zero rated. So the trading of pure gold, investment gold is zero rated. We know that education services are zero rated. So this is where you can start to get a little bit more personal with VAT, because aside from all of the business consequences of VAT, then most people are genuinely interested in what does it mean for me too. Okay, so we know that if education is zero rated, then if you've got kids at school, you're not going to have to pay VAT on the cost. So your school fees aren't going up by 5% next year. That's a good thing. And then let's assume that you get sick, okay? So if you get sick, are you going to have to pay VAT on your health bill? Well, no, because the VAT, you're paying it, but it's at 0%. So there's no additional cost for healthcare from next year. However, if you did want to do something that was elective or cosmetic, then you've got 16 days to get booked in, get your surgery done, pay for it, and walk out the hospital before you have to pay an extra 5% VAT. Okay, because anything that's elective or cosmetic and not for necessary healthcare will be subject to VAT at 5%. If you happen to be buying a new house, so a new residence or a new apartment, then actually there's an exception in the legislation that says a new house, a new dwelling, will be zero rated. Why would they do that? Well, there's a couple of reasons. If you think of the developer, so the person who's actually constructing the residence, okay, if they were to pass VAT on to you, then the whole cost of residences in the UAE would go up by 5%. So that's quite a significant additional cost. Given the value, that's a significant additional cost to all of us. So in order to keep the property prices at a reasonable level, the developer can construct the residence, they can sell it on to any one of us, and we pay VAT at 0%. But remember the earlier argument, if they pay VAT at 0%, then they're entitled to get all the VAT back on the cost of building the house or building the apartment. If I flip quickly onto the exemption, any subsequent sale or lease either of an existing property or of a new property after that first sale is VAT exempt. So that means that for all of us who either lease our apartments or who are buying apartments, the VAT is exempt. So we're not actually paying any VAT at all. So again, think about your personal expenses. There's not going to be VAT on your residence. But it also means that the landlord, if you have one, is not entitled to get the VAT back perhaps on the repairs or maintenance or service charges or anything else that they have. So they might want to have a little think about the price, but it's not VAT. Okay, so the other things that are likely to be exempt, so the sale of bare land. So if you happen to trade in land, then you know that if it's a bare piece of land with no infrastructure, no buildings, not even partially constructed buildings, then we know that that's going to be VAT exempt. And that will be a very limited number of cases. Local passenger transport. So if you happen to get the metro every morning, okay, if you happen to get the bus, if you get an RTA taxi, all of that will be VAT exempt. So you won't have a personal expense, but if you're, it also means that these organisations will not be able to recover their VAT. And then finally on financial services. So financial services are also exempt, but only insofar as they are margin based. So what does that mean? Well, that typically means that the margin, so it would typically be something like an interest charge. Or if it was an Islamic product, it would typically be the profit element. So those parts will be VAT exempt. Everything else will be plus VAT at 5. So even the fees from your bank would be plus VAT at 5%. Okay, so that's covered that quite widely, but it does give you an indication of if it's not in those two lists, it's plus VAT at 5. Now I mentioned there's also this deemed supply rule. And effectively what that does is for a VAT purpose, it recognises that there has been a supply, so you have to account for VAT, but that supply is a pretend supply because it didn't actually take place. But it's an accounting treatment. You still have to identify it and you still have to account for VAT on it. So typically it occurs when you make a supply of goods or services and you don't charge. So you're still in business, but you make a supply and you're not charging for it, for whatever reason. And essentially the reason the rule's here is so that what you don't do is give away your goods and services and the benefit of your goods and services for free. And effectively what the government are saying is that they're not going to fund that for you. So you have to do an accounting adjustment in order to declare the VAT. Okay. So moving on to VAT and trying to get some of the technical areas issued. I'll just build this up quickly. Okay, so I don't propose to go through every single one of these, but essentially what's on this slide are all of the rules on VAT. Okay, so we need rules to tell us what's the time of supply. Because if you get the time of supply wrong, then actually you could be declaring VAT in a tax period that you shouldn't be. So that can result in an error. And guess what? If you have an error, you get a penalty. That's going to cost you money. So let's get the rules around time of supply right. There's also rules that tell you when you have to register for VAT and who can register. We need rules to tell us what the place of supply is, so that we know whether that transaction takes place actually here in the UAE or does it take place somewhere else, in which case it's irrelevant. And then when it comes to compliance, how often do we have to complete and submit a VAT return? When do we have to submit it by? Who's responsible for doing it? So we need some rules around that. Then finally, we also need rules to tell us what we can recover VAT on. We need rules around the scope of tax, which we've pretty much covered because it's almost everything. And then what the rates are, which we've already covered. So place of supply. So the first thing is we need the rules to determine whether the place of supply is the UAE or outside the UAE. If the supply takes place here, then it's plus VAT. If it takes place outside the UAE, then obviously there's no UAE VAT to be included. Now on the rules, there are different rules for the place of supply of goods and different rules for the place of supply services. They're not the same. For goods, the basic rule is the place of supply of the location of the goods when they're provided. Okay? So if I decide to sell you this chair today, we're all in the UAE, of course it's going to be subject to UAE VAT. Okay? If the chair happens to be in China, and I'm selling it to someone in the US, then it's completely outside the scope of UAE. Okay, so it's generally easy to follow from the place of supply of goods. For services, there is a slightly different rule. And for services, it very much depends on whether or not you're supplying services to a consumer or whether you're providing them to a business customer. So if you're providing services to the end user, then the VAT is based on where you are located. So we're all sitting here, so if I'm providing services to an individual, plus VAT at 5%. If I'm providing services to a business customer, then the place of supply is where that business customer is resident. Now, if you think about that, that actually shifts the place of supply and can actually take that place of supply to outside the UAE. But one of the things about VAT is that each and every time there is a transaction that goes that way, there'll be an equal and opposite transaction coming this way. So both the outputs and the inputs are mirror images of one another. So whilst we're saying that the place of supply can shift to where your business customer is, that also means if you buy in services, if you import services, then the place of supply comes from where your supplier is right back into the UAE, and you have to account for the VAT on that even though you've not been charged any. So that's called the reverse charge mechanism, and we've got a slide on that coming up. In the meantime, let's jump back to goods. So if we take three examples. So the first is domestic supplies, so supplies that take place in the UAE, and this is pretty vanilla, it's plain straightforward. The goods are sitting in Abu Dhabi, they are either collected or delivered to Dubai, and is there VAT on it? Of course there is, plus VAT 5%. If you export the goods, you're sending the goods outside, let's say we're sending them to Europe, then that's a zero rate supply. Because remember we said we didn't want to adversely impact the cost of international trade, so that's zero rated. And then finally, if we're buying something from Europe and bringing it into the UAE, well actually we would have to pay import VAT. And that import VAT is done via the same reverse charge mechanism. So, okay, so can I come on to talk about GCC in just a few minutes, okay? Let me do it now. Let me cover the time of the place of supply just now. So KSA, I said that there were two countries that were implementing VAT from the 1st of January. And the rules are different when you're supplying goods or services or being provided by goods or services from another GCC implementing state. And the key phrase is this implementing state. So at the moment, up until a week ago, the only other implementing state was going to be KSA. However, the way in which KSA are implementing VAT is a different threshold for people to register for VAT, which means that they are not fully implementing VAT on the strength of the GCC framework. The framework, and in fact the Saudi law, also says that when you have two implementing states working together, there has to be a mechanism to be able to look through from one country to another and see what those transactions were. Well, actually, that system is not up and running yet, and it's not likely to be for quite some time. So we were advised by the FTA just last week that although we had been gaily, everyone in the country and KSA had been going along assuming that the services to KSA would be treated as a GCC state, the reality is now, for the course of next year, they will be treated the same as the rest of the world. So anything that you sell to any of the other member states will be treated as if it was going anywhere else and it would be zero rated. And if you're importing something, the same rules would apply. Okay, so at the moment, there's no difference from GCC to the rest of the world. Okay, there will be at some point, but for just now, there is no difference between the two types of supplies. Yes?
If you import any goods from the GCC area into the UAE, mm-hmm. and in this country like Bahrain, Kuwait, Oman, there is no implementation of VAT yet, mm-hmm. does this mean there is a potential VAT arbitrage?
Not really, no. No, because the rules would be exactly the same. And the reason why is that from an importer's perspective or from a business perspective, remember VAT shouldn't be a cost to your business. So the VAT that you incur, you're also entitled to claim back, which would be just the same as if you weren't charged VAT in the first place for the other member states. So there shouldn't be an arbitrage. Okay, so time of supply. So Sorry? Sorry, I can't. Sorry. Time of supply. So the time of supply determines when you actually have to account for VAT. And we'll do some slides on this because it's really important to get the time of supply right, particularly when you're looking at transition. So we will have supplies that will take place now. We might have some supplies that will already have started, and they will still be taking place next June. So how do you work out where VAT sits? How do you work out where you would be charging VAT and which supplies there won't be VAT on? Well, here's the general rule. The rule for VAT is that it's the earlier of when the goods are supplied, when the services are performed, or when you raise the invoice, or when you receive payment. So it's quite clever. It makes sure that the earliest possible opportunity VAT is being accounted for. So recovery of input tax. So you get in, you're going to receive invoices for the supplies that you buy. And how much of that is going to be recoverable? Well, hopefully all of it, but in reality it won't be. So what can you claim a credit for input tax on? So input tax is the goods coming into your business as opposed to those supplies that you're making, which are output tax. So inputs. So you can claim back VAT on taxable supplies, so you charge VAT. You can claim back VAT on supplies which are made outside the state but would have been taxable here. So that covers things like if you're selling goods to you're selling goods to KSA, if you're selling goods to Europe, to China, doesn't matter, you're still entitled to claim back your VAT. If you're making exempt supplies, remember you're not allowed to you're not allowed to recover VAT, but there is an exception that says if you're making exempt supplies outside the state or outside the GCC, then those are treated as still with the benefit of recovery. So there is an exception there. The first supply of a residential building, remember a new supply. And then we do have a bit of implement. So VAT paid in an implementing state on goods that are acquired or imported and brought into the UAE. And if you have anything that you're providing to your employees, typically the VAT would be recoverable. But let me stop there, because one of the key things that VAT is not recoverable on are private cars. So, and not a plug for some of my retail clients who sell cars, but if you were going to be buying a car, if you buy it now, there will be VAT. If you buy it from the 1st of January, there will be 5% VAT on it. And whilst I said that VAT is typically not a cost, we already know that if the car is used for any private use whatsoever, then you're not entitled to claim the VAT back. So there's my top tip for your shopping between now and the end of the year. If you're wanting a new car, I would get in and order it quite soon. So the other thing that allows you the credit, so how do you prove that you're entitled to get a VAT credit? Well, actually, the documentation is essential. So you need a valid VAT invoice. That's not the same as any other invoice. There are certain things that have to be on the invoice in order for it to be valid from a VAT perspective. And we've got an example to show you. The other thing is that you do have to have the intention to pay the invoice within 6 months. And the reason that's there is because there is an equal and opposite impact. So if you don't pay the invoice within the 6 months, then actually the supplier would be entitled to claim back the VAT under a bad debt relief scheme. And you would effectively be in default. So you have to intend to pay the invoice in order to get the entitlement to credit. So all of that is recoverable. So what's not recoverable? Well, what's not recoverable, the motor vehicle we've discussed, but actually also business entertainment. And this is a typical grey area, and it's a typical grey area across the world because it's quite subjective. How do you determine what is business entertainment as opposed to a subsistence fee or something else? So it is a grey area, but generally if the purpose of the event is to entertain, if you're taking your customers out for a jolly good time, then generally you would not be entitled to claim back the VAT. Also, if you're buying something that's for a personal benefit and not for the benefit of the business, then understandably you're not entitled to claim the VAT back for that. And there is a quirky rule. So if you were if you were importing goods, but they were being transshipped to elsewhere in the GCC, then actually they're saying that the VAT on that is not currently recoverable, which was an issue for a lot of businesses. But given that we're not treating anyone else as an implementing state for now, it's less of an issue. Okay, so on imports, how do you work out the VAT on imports? Well, the valuation is incredibly important. So the first thing is you get the cost of the goods. But you actually have to add on any of the insurance, freight, so that you get to the fully landed price of the goods. Okay, so it's the full landed price. There will then be customs duty. And there may be, if the product is within the excise regime, there might also be excise tax. And so you add up the cost of all of these things together, and that gives you a value. And VAT is on that full landed price value. So in this occasion, what we're saying is, if you stripped it right back, we're saying that the cost of goods is only $10,000. But we know that the landed price, the insurance and the freight, gets up to 12. We get 5% customs duty, so we're then up to 12.5. We get excise tax, let's assuming it's 100% on the cost of the goods, so we're now up to an extra 20. And so the VAT is on the 32,600. So the VAT actually is 1,630, 5%. Okay. So we mentioned reverse charge, and reverse charge is available for import VAT. So the reason reverse charge is particularly helpful for business is that if you're importing something, whether it's goods or services, rather than paying the VAT and waiting to claim it back, you actually get to put the accounting entry straight onto your VAT return. So there is no cash flow implication for reverse charge. But it is incredibly important that you identify the goods and services that you import and make sure they're properly accounted for, because if you don't, then you'd be seen to be non-compliant. And the other thing about reverse charge, remember it's a self-accounting tax, but effectively what you're doing is you're saying that you're both buying something and selling something at the same time. Now, for most of you, what that would mean is that you buy it and you claim it back in the same VAT return, because if you're making supplies that are subject to 5%, you get it all back anyway. But let's say you're making an exempt supply. Well, then you still have to declare the VAT on the sale, so you get 5 on this side, but you get nothing on that side. But if you think about it, that puts you in exactly the same position as you would have been in if you had bought the same services or the same goods locally. Because locally, you would have been charged 5% VAT. So the purpose of reverse charge is to assist with cash flow on one level, but what it does do is it avoids distortion of competition, because whether you buy something locally or whether you buy it elsewhere, the VAT treatment will be exactly the same. Okay. So registration. So there was lots of hands for registration. So here are the limits. I'll just build this up. So if your turnover, if your taxable turnover, and remember we've already worked out what taxable supplies are, but if your taxable turnover is more than 375,000 dirhams, then actually it's mandatory that you register for VAT. You don't have a choice. Well, you do have a choice, but it's not one I would recommend. If you do not register for VAT in time, then the penalty for failing to register for VAT at the same time is 20,000 dirhams. Okay, so you want to make sure that you're registered so that you're compliant. If your turnover was between 187,000 and 375,000 dirhams, then it is possible to register on a voluntary basis. Now, you might think, why would I bother? You know, if I don't have to be part of this VAT club, I can live without it. And for many of you, that might be right. But if the VAT that you charge on to your customers is fully recoverable by them, then it's not an actual cost to them. If you're not registered, you cannot claim back the VAT on your costs. If you're registered and you can pass it on to your customers, then that's a good thing. So you end up having a, you end up not having an additional VAT cost. So here's the thing. Let's say you were buying, you're buying the same, let's do goods because they're easy. You're buying the same goods and you have two different suppliers who have given you their quotes, okay? One of them is registered for VAT and their quote is for 105,000 dirhams. They're registered for VAT, so they're charging you 5,000 dirhams, 105,000 dirhams. The other supplier, whose goods are equally as equivalent value, equally as good, so there's no difference between the quality of the product or the quality of the supplier, but the other one is charging you 102,000 dirhams. How many of you would go for the 102,000, which appears cheaper? No one? Really? Okay, there's a couple of hands. So effectively, the 105 actually ends up being cheaper as long as you're registered for VAT. Because that 5,000 you get to claim back. So the actual net cost for the 105 is only 100,000. The 102,000 is probably from someone who's not registered and they're not able to claim back the VAT and their cost, so they're trying to push some of it onto you. So it's important to kind of recognise and work back from the final position to see where you can end up. Now, there were some other limits, some other registration requirements. If I just touch on those for a minute. So the FTA did say that for any business that had a turnover of over 150 million dirhams, they needed to register for VAT by the 31st of October. Anyone who had a registration of over 10 million dirhams had to register for VAT by the 30th of November. And then there's everyone else up until the end of December. So potentially, if you required to be registered, if you were above those limits, then you're possibly registering late. Okay? The other thing is that if you are required to be registered, I would encourage you to do so urgently. Two reasons. One, because you want to make sure your application is in before the end of the year in order to mitigate any penalties that might be due. But the second reason is that, oh, actually, I'm going to ask a question. So of the people who raised their hands and said that they had applied for registration, how many of you have actually received a registration number? And not a TIN, the actual tax registration number. How many of you received numbers? 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay, so about 10 people. And can I just go back to that show of hands of how many of you had registered? Okay. A lot more than 10. So one of the things with the FTA is that it will take them 20 working days to process a VAT registration. We don't have 20 working days left to the end of the year. So there is a high probability that there will be many businesses who don't actually have their VAT registration number by the time VAT is introduced. So remember, if you don't have your VAT registration number, you can't include it on your invoices. You're not entitled to charge VAT onto your customers. So that's a practical thing to work through in terms of what that would mean for you. Okay, so moving on with compliance, we said that VAT is self-accounting. So it's down to you to actually account for VAT on your own. And to be fair to the FTA, they have offered a lot of assistance. And you know what, DMCC have been absolutely amazing in terms of offering sessions like this and lots of additional guidance. I know if you look at their website, there's tons of information to help you with VAT. So I would definitely encourage you to have a look at that. The FTA have also got quite a lot of helpful information coming through on their website as well, so that's somewhere else to look. But in order to comply with VAT, you do actually have to have books of account, okay? You will typically submit your VAT return. Now, the standard VAT returns are to be submitted on a quarterly basis. And that doesn't mean for everyone that it'll be March, June, September, and December, because the FTA will stagger those VAT returns over the whole year to make sure that they have a regular routine rather than all coming at once. But for those businesses that are over 150 million dirham turnover, they're classed as large businesses. So as a large business, That means that you then have to register for VAT. So once you register for VAT, you have to complete and submit your returns on a monthly basis, not on a quarterly basis. You have to keep your records for 5 years, unless, of course, it's real estate, in which case it's 15 years. And there is actually a schedule, I won't go into it today, but there is a schedule on the FTA website if you happen to want to look up for penalties. Now, VAT returns are due by the 28th day following the end of your tax period. So here's a bit of a tip. The first VAT returns are going to be due to be submitted and paid by the 28th of February. But in order to pay your VAT return, the FTA are only accepting two types of payments. The first payment is via your corporate credit card or your personal credit card if that covers your VAT liability. But if you pay by credit card, it will cost you an extra 2%. So I am not personally recommending that you get a credit card out to pay your VAT bill. The only other way to pay VAT is via an eDirham account. If you do not already have an eDirham account and you're required to complete and submit a VAT return, I would encourage you to get an eDirham account over the next 4 or 5 weeks. Because it will take the bank at least 5 working days to set up your eDirham account. Okay? So if you think you're going to complete and submit your VAT return, you're waiting to the end of February, and you go in and then you can't pay it, you're already in default. So get your eDirham account because it'll make life an awful lot easier when you can actually come to complete and submit your returns from a financial perspective. Okay, now we mentioned Emirate reporting. So VAT is a federal tax, all right? So what that means is that the federal government is responsible for assessing tax. It's responsible for collecting the tax. And so the federal government will get all of the money from VAT, and they will take as much as they need in order to run the business of government. But, it also means that each emirate is going to want to get its fair share of the tax. So how do they work out how much each emirate is entitled to get back? Well, it's for that very reason that there is emirate reporting on your VAT return. So you have to be able to identify the consumption. So where does something actually get consumed? And that's not the end-to-end consumer, it's just your consumer. So if you're making a supply in Abu Dhabi, you would declare Abu Dhabi on your return. If it's Dubai, then of course it's going to be Dubai. But you have to be able to identify the seven emirates and any transactions that occur within each of the seven emirates. Okay, so I said I would give you an example of a tax invoice, and this is it. So the regulations are specifically in Article 59 of the exec regs. But on your VAT, on a proper tax invoice, and bear in mind you need this for two reasons. So this tax invoice is the invoice that you need to complete and give to your customers. But if you receive an invoice and it doesn't include all of this information, then you know already that you're not able to claim the VAT back. Okay, so you need to be able to identify. It's got to have your tax registration number on it. That's what your TRN is. So the difficulties of not having your number by January then start to become more clear. Obviously, you need your own name and address on it, and you must have a recognised invoice number that comes from a sequence. And I won't run through the rest, but effectively you get the idea. This is absolutely critical. And then, for those of you that are in retail and you may be selling, there's a high volume of goods. So if you go to Carrefour for your shopping, for example, Carrefour, if I go back a step, Carrefour aren't going to wait and ask you for your name and your address. Are you registered for VAT? And issue a full tax invoice. No retailer will. So instead, they get to issue a simplified tax invoice, effectively the till receipt. So the till receipt has even less information on it. And provided it's for goods and services to a consumer and it's less than 10,000 dirhams, then they can use this method instead. Okay, so that should make it a little bit easier for some. And then the other part is you've raised the invoice, and let's say there's a problem with the supply that you've made, or maybe you've charged the wrong amount, Or maybe you've charged them for 5 items and actually there was only 4. Or you've sent out the wrong colour. Who knows? The reality is that credit notes happen all the time. So the tax credit note is effectively a mirror image of the tax invoice. But in addition to that, you actually have to show the amount of VAT, the gross amount, the net amount, and the amount of VAT. But you also have to show the difference between what was on your invoice, the new amount, and the difference. So there's a lot of extra administration from a credit note perspective. Okay. So transition provisions. So we talked about the time of supply. And the time of supply going forward into VAT is important to get the VAT return right. But for the next several weeks, actually, the time of supply is really important in order to work out whether or not the supplies of goods and services that you're making currently might actually be subject to VAT if they fall into 2018. So how do we determine what's in 2017 and not subject to VAT, and what's in 2018 and would be a consequence of a VAT treatment? So let's have some examples. So in 2018, in February, you order goods or services. In March, the goods are delivered or the services performed. In June, you get an invoice. And then in September, you finally get paid. So give me a show of hands. How many people think that the VAT would be due on the 12th of February? Okay, a couple. How many think that VAT would be due on the 18th of March? A few more. How many people think June? Some more. How many think September? Okay, so it's a good mix. And how many people couldn't put their hands up? All right. So the VAT is actually due in March. Because remember, the time of supply rules were the earlier of the goods being delivered or the service being performed, the invoice being issued, or the payment being received. So the fact that the goods were delivered in March, that's when the VAT is due. Okay? So a couple of other examples just to demonstrate this provision, particularly around about the deadline date. So we've ordered goods and services earlier this year. So 1st of November, we've ordered goods and services. The goods are delivered on the 18th of December. Sorry, the invoice is issued on the 18th of December. The goods are delivered in January. And I pay for them on the 15th of February. Show of hands for November. We'll make this quick. Quick fire. No one? Okay, that's good. Show of hands for December, because that's when they raise the invoice. Some? Okay. Show of hands for January. Okay. And for payment in February. Okay, and there were a lot of you didn't put your hands up there, because I get to see. So I know a lot of people couldn't make their minds up. Effectively, the VAT is actually due on the 1st of January, because even though the invoice was issued by the vendor in December, the goods weren't actually provided until the VAT regime had come in. So the invoice, from a VAT perspective, was irrelevant. It happened in 2017. So the VAT is due on that particular supply. So one more. So we order goods and services in November. They are delivered in January. They are invoiced in 2nd of January, and they are paid in February. VAT due on the 1st of January, because that's when the goods were delivered. Okay. And this is the last one. So November, ordered. December, the goods were delivered. January, the invoice is issued, and February, the payment is made. So let's just do a show of hands for one side of the other. Do we think VAT is due on this supply? Show of hands for yes. Okay, all right. The answer is no. Because actually, the transaction was fulfilled. The goods were actually delivered in December. So as long as you take actual possession of the goods in December, or your services complete, then actually you manage to beat VAT being introduced. Okay, so when I was talking about you ordering a new car, if you were to use the car as an example, it's not good enough that you go and you order your car and you pay for it. You actually have to take delivery in December in order to beat VAT. Okay, so here's some examples of specific transaction flows that are like that we know are relevant within DMCC. So the first one is we have a buyer. So if we look at the commodity trading company in the middle, okay, so that's let's have our focus on that one first of all. So you have an order from an overseas buyer, okay? And in order to fulfill that order, you have to place your own order to someone else who's also overseas. The overseas person manages the flow of goods that come directly from where they are to wherever your customer is. And all that's happening is you're sitting in the UAE in the middle. So the supply actually doesn't come all the way through the UAE, but you're still the one making the supply. You're still actually issuing an invoice. So you receive an invoice from the manufacturer and you issue an invoice to the overseas buyer. So in this case, it's outside the scope of VAT because it didn't actually take place in the UAE. Now, if this matches the supply chain that you have, you're actually still entitled to register for VAT. Because remember we said that you are allowed to register for VAT if the supplies that you make are outside the state but would be taxable if they were here. And it's obvious that this supply would be taxable if it was here. Okay, so you could register, and the benefit of registering is you get the VAT back in your costs. Okay? So let's go to another example. Again, you're sitting in the middle. You have a customer overseas, so they place an order. And actually, in order to fulfill that order, you buy locally. So you buy from someone else in DMCC. Well, actually, if the supply of goods is going overseas, we know that that's zero rated. But actually, if the supply is to someone else in DMCC or someone within the UAE, then that's going to be plus VAT at 5%. Okay, so that's fairly straightforward. So, let's say we've got a DMCC gold polishing company. Okay, many of you exist. So, in order to fulfill your transactions, you have a customer who's overseas, but you also have customers in DMCC. If you're providing the services to overseas, then we know that that's zero rated. So we've already established that through the other supply chains and through the earlier commentary. If, however, the services are to someone in DMCC, then they are plus VAT at 5%, standard rated. Okay? And I know lots of people are taking photographs, and I don't mind you taking photographs at all, but just to remind you, I think the entire presentation will be on DMCC's website. Is that right? Yeah, it will be on DMCC's website quite soon. So that will allow you to go back and refer to it and work your way through. Okay? All right, so let's look at another example. So again, DMCC sitting in the middle. So to your right-hand side, you have customers in GCC countries which have implemented VAT. Now, we know as of last week that they won't exist for some time, at least for a year, but they will exist at some point, so it's useful to go through the rules for them. And then we have other customers in GCC countries which have not implemented the VAT law, which is basically everyone else just now. So, if they've not implemented the VAT law, they're treated the same as the rest of the world's supplies. They're treated as an export, so they're going to be zero rated. And if and when they are an implementing state, they're then treated under the reverse charge. So you can still make the supply to them. You don't actively charge them VAT because it's treated as outside the scope, but they're the ones who have to do the reverse charge. They have to treat it as a supply that they've received and sold themselves. Okay, so another example. So in this one, the transaction on your right, trying to get my left and my right here, but on your right, is then outside the scope. Because again, you've, in order to fulfill the transaction, your supplier is overseas, but your buyer is also overseas. Okay? So outside the scope of VAT. If your customer's overseas, that's going to be zero rated. And I'm sure I'm going in the wrong direction here. Okay, here we go. All right, so you have a manufacturer overseas. They provide you with services. And the DMCC, we know that that's going to be subject to the reverse charge because you're importing services. Okay, so remember we said that if you were importing services or goods, they're subject to reverse charge. So you account for VAT as a sale and as a purchase, okay? And actually, if you were ordering from the same service from someone who's local, then you would be charged VAT. So on your left, both transactions are subject to VAT at 5%. But from, remember this investment gold, so pure gold, as long as it's 99.9% pure, is actually zero rated.
So 99.9.
We'll confirm in just a second. So if it's classed as investment gold, then it's going to be zero rated. Okay, I'll confirm the percentage for you. So 99, okay. Sorry, I can't hear you. I can't hear, sorry.
So the conditions, there is two conditions. One is 99% of the book, mm-hmm. And the second condition is irrelevant law.
Yeah, okay, yes, so it has to be traded. Uh-huh. So it has to, the difference here is it's not jewellery, it has to be actually investment grade gold. Okay, so it has to be investment gold. Anchor, have you got the answer? 99? I think it's 99. We'll confirm, but I think it's 99. Apologies, I read off the slide. Okay, so we'll come back to that one. But in the meantime, we have left some time for questions because I am mindful that for the next 35 minutes, you have the opportunity to get free VAT advice.
If you are a gold refinery who imports gold ore, that means gold, say, containing 90% gold-containing rock, which will be refined, it will be refined into a zero-rated product, is anybody in this chain, importer, refinery, being VAT charged, or is this the reverse charge mechanism?
So when you import the gold, so if you import the gold, and let's say it's not investment grade gold, but if you're importing the gold, then you would still have to be subject to reverse charge VAT.
So it's a reverse charge.
So when you import, it's reverse charge. When you then provide the service of refining, that service is plus VAT at 5%. Because it's a service, okay?
The charge for the refinery, the total refining charge, mm-hmm. That's 5% VAT.
Yes.
Not a question. The goods would come in.
Are subject to reverse
and
charge.
It will be refined to a zero rated product.
Yes.
So there must be a reverse charge mechanism.
No, so there is. So when the goods, if we take the three supplies, okay? So actually there's three supplies you're talking about. The first supply is you import the gold, okay? You import the gold,
yeah.
Okay? So you import the gold, and therefore, that's subject to reverse charge VAT. And now here's another thing. If you haven't already completed your application for VAT registration, or if you have, and you haven't added on your customs number, I would encourage you to do so now. And the reason for that is that One of the questions on the VAT application form was, what is your customs number? If you did not include that, I will answer the rest of your question, it's just while this is in my mind. If you didn't include that, then that means that you will have a VAT number, you will have a separate and distinct customs number, and the two are not connected. If these two are not connected in the tax authority's infrastructure, that means that you're not going to be allowed to do reverse charge, and you would actually have to pay the VAT and then wait to claim it back. So actually giving them the evidence that you have a customs number is absolutely critical if you want to benefit from the reverse charge. So a lot, I'm mindful that several people missed that step because they just wanted to get the application in quickly, which I understand, but actually there is a consequence to that, which is that you might not be allowed to do reverse charge until the infrastructure is settled. So let's assume then that you have given your customs number to the tax authority. So your customs number and your VAT number are connected. Then you import the gold. It's subject to reverse charge, so you don't have to pay the VAT up front. You can put it straight onto your VAT return. So that's transaction one. Transaction two is you then refine the gold. Now that's a supply of services. And if those services are to someone else within the UAE, that's plus VAT at 5%. Okay, now at that point, the gold's gone to that person. Then the next supply is if you sell the gold and it is now 99% pure, so it's now pure gold, well, that supply would be zero rated. Okay, so you have three different supplies, and in this occasion, all three have different VAT treatments. Okay, another question?
If I supply the item less than cost price, what measures should they take? Maybe decrease the input tax or something else?
So I suppose if I maybe turn that around and ask you another question, which is why would you be providing it less than cost price? Is that something you would do on a regular basis or?
Marketing, for example.
Sorry?
Marketing.
Can't hear you.
Marketing expense.
Marketing expenses.
Yes.
So, okay, so I just want to be, there's two different answers to this. I just want to be really specific on the question. So you're providing, the overall supply is less than cost price because your cost price, it would include your marketing expenses. Is that what you're saying?
No,
or?
My price is less than cost.
Okay.
For example, for some item, I put the price is less than cost.
Uh-huh.
To get customer to my shop, for example.
Okay. So a bit of a loss leader.
Huh?
A loss leader to attract people in so that you get the business. Okay. So the basic rules are that VAT is due on the value of the consideration. So if the consideration, the price, ends up being less than cost, then actually that's still the price at which VAT is due. You are still entitled to recover the VAT on your costs in full. But the reason I was hesitating was if you are always supplying goods that are less than cost, then you're not making any money, so you're not in business. So you can see why that would be a question. And the other caveat that I would put here is that if you're providing something less than cost to another entity that is an associated entity, so if it's an entity that is associated with you, then there is anti-avoidance legislation that says you cannot make it less than cost price. Okay, so if you're supplying to an associate entity, you're going to have to look at the market value. All right, any other questions? Yes?
I just had a question regarding the retentions.
Mm-hmm.
When you're leading the real estate and you have all the retentions, how does that come in with the time of supply as well?
Okay. Okay, so it's a really good question and it's been hotly debated, I can tell you, over recent weeks. So typically it could work one of two ways. And ultimately, it will depend on your contract. It will depend on what you have agreed between the parties and what your paperwork says. So the retention can work in this way, which is you have supplied the, let's say it's construction services, so you supply the construction services in full. There is a 10% retention, which is payable after a year. But because you provided it in full, you raise an invoice for 100% of the value. So if you've raised an invoice for 100% of the value and the construction is complete, then actually the time of supply is when you raise that invoice. So the retention payment that you get a year later may not therefore be subject to VAT. But if all of that happens within a VAT regime, then what you have done is you've advanced your VAT payment by at least 12 months. The other alternative is that you raise an invoice for 90%, and the 10%, the retention, is actually a promise that if something was to go wrong, then you will provide the goods or services over the course of the year, and when that is complete, you'll then raise the retention payment and get paid at the end of the year. And in that situation, then the retention payment is subject to VAT, okay, which is actually the safest way to do it. So that's the way I would recommend, because it's the cleanest, most transparent way, and it's also the best from a cash flow perspective. Okay? Yes?
If a supplier comes to our services, made in November, and the invoice also shows in November, but the amount will be received on January.
Okay.
Will be subject for VAT.
Okay, so just to confirm your question for everyone else, so the service was consumed in November, the invoice was raised in November, but the payment was made in February. Okay, so if the invoice was made in November, if the goods were provided in November, and the payment just happens to come in February 2018, then the time of supply was actually November, so it's free of VAT. No VAT on your payment. Not on your payment. Okay?
Sorry, but if the invoice is with outside company in Antwerp, it will send for us some money.
Sorry.
The same is outside of Dubai.
Okay, so different questions coming at me here, so hold on.
Providing services outside UAE.
So you're providing services outside UAE, okay?
Okay.
Uh-huh.
That invoice was the same company inside UAE. While accessing the other invoices to a company inside UAE.
Uh-huh.
But all the services outside UAE. Mm-hmm. So would it be taxable or not?
So because it's to a business customer, because the place of supply of services are where the business customer is resident. So if you're invoicing a business resident in the UAE, even if your services are performed elsewhere, then actually it's still subject to UAE VAT. If your business customer was outside the UAE and that's who you were invoicing, then it would be outside the scope of VAT. It's like an exported service. Okay? Yes, but you said that you're invoicing a business in the UAE. So if you're invoicing, the rules for that are straightforward. If you're invoicing a business in the UAE for services, it will be subject to VAT at 5%. If you were invoicing a business who's not in the UAE and you're exporting your service, then the place of supply is where that business is located. And they would have to reverse charge. Okay? All right, yes.
You have mentioned the zero waste services, zero waste tax.
Okay, can I maybe ask a favour? Because I know there's quite a lot of chatter, but just so that we all get the benefit of the questions, thank you. All right, go ahead.
Regarding this zero waste tax, international transportation license services for zero waste.
Uh-huh.
So for example, a company which is registered in DMCC is operating vessels.
Uh-huh.
With transporting cargo from UK to other part outside mm-hmm. of UAE, the goods are not coming even to Dubai.
Uh-huh.
Such company, the service is provided by the invoice is based in UAE. In such scenario, mm-hmm. whether this company is liable to collect VAT.
Okay, so the supply you're talking about, so you're effectively doing international transport, say from the UK to Azerbaijan. The services are provided by a company in DMCC. Where are they being billed to? Where do you issue your invoice to?
The goods are going from UK to, for example, India.
Okay, so if the goods are going from the UK to India, then the place of supply is not in the UAE. So it's completely outside, because the goods never come into the UAE at all, so therefore they're not subject to VAT. But you would be entitled to register for VAT, because if that same supply took place in the UAE, it would be subject to VAT. Okay? You're welcome. Yes?
My DMCC company is doing brokerage between suppliers and importers. Both are out of UAE.
Okay, so brokerage services to companies outside the UAE. So typically, because they're outside the UAE, you would follow the same place of supply rules, which would be if the customer's outside the UAE, then the place of supply will be where they're located. So you wouldn't charge them VAT. It would be subject to reverse charge wherever they are located, but you would still be entitled to register for VAT and claim back the VAT in your costs, assuming that you're above the registration threshold. Okay? All right. Yes? Okay, so it's a good question. So if I answer that slightly differently, so aside from the fact that you get a lovely badge of honour of being a DMCC company, from a VAT perspective, whether you're a DMCC company or a mainland company or any other free zone company, from a VAT perspective, it doesn't matter. It's still the same. So you still have to follow the same principles and the same requirements in order to comply with VAT. Okay? Let's drop. Yes? Okay, so 99% pure is, as it says on the tin, tradable in global markets is the point about being investment gold. So you're more likely to trade investment gold than you would trade, say, a piece of jewellery, or I'm not saying you would never trade jewellery, but it's about the investment side of it. Okay? Yes?
Our company is not making any sales, we are not doing any purchase. The company only afford the expenses here.
Okay.
So the expenses which we paid, for example, Diva bill or Ypsilon bill, we are paid for 5% tax. That VAT will be recoverable, right?
So going back to the first, hold on just before we take the mic away. So the first thing is that you're not making any sales, so you don't have any income in the UAE, but you do have expenses. So where does your income come from to cover your expenses?
The expenses will be paid through the headquarters.
Okay. So where's the headquarters?
In Austria.
In Austria. Okay, so the headquarters in Austria, all that you're doing here is incurring the costs. So if you go back to first principles, you actually have to be in business in order to be registered for VAT. So if you're not actually making any taxable supplies in the UAE, you cannot register. But then have a think about what is it that the headquarters does, because you have to be here for a reason. Okay, so you're going to be doing something, whether it's sales and marketing, whether it's as a representative office, but there will be something. And the key thing here is, are you a separate legal entity, or are you the child of the parent head office? Okay, so you are the entity. So because you are the entity, you can't separate the parent from the child. Okay, so it's a bit like saying right pocket, left pocket. You can't separate the being. So the legal entity is one person. So then you have to look beyond what you are doing as a rep office or a sales office. And then you look at what the bigger picture is and what is it that the entity is doing in order to determine whether or not the entity through you can register for VAT. And if it can, then you register and then you'd be entitled to claim your VAT back. Okay? You're welcome.
Just a question about the duty free zone. Mm-hmm. Are they exempt from
Okay, I think that the phrase duty-free is a bit of a misconcept because even if you were to, even as a private individual, if we were to go into the airports, you quite often see duty-free. In reality, quite often it's not duty-free, it's a sales gimmick. So there would be no difference if you were supplying goods or services in Jebel Ali, in DAFSA, in Ras Al Khaimah, or in DMCC. The treatment would be exactly the same, but for one condition. And this will only apply in a limited number of cases. So one of the things that we've yet to learn from the FTA is where designated zones are. So free zones are irrelevant from a VAT perspective, but there is a concept called designated zone. So a designated zone is an area that is border controlled. So there is a physical border, it restricts, it's customs controlled, and it restricts the movement of goods and people into and out of that area. So why bother? So the benefit of having a designated zone is that if you transact within the designated zone, then the supply of goods from one party to another inside the designated zone, but only inside the designated zone, will be free of VAT. If you happen to import and immediately re-export, then if it comes through the designated zone, then the VAT is overlooked as well, as is duty. But if you're providing services, even services within the designated zone will be subject to VAT at 5%. If you're selling goods into a designated zone, it will still be subject to VAT at 5%. And when the goods are coming out of the designated zone, then you have to pay import VAT and duty just the same as you would ordinarily. So the duty-free concept tends to be more of a sales and marketing gimmick, if I'm honest, but the designated zone area is specifically relevant where businesses are trading in goods, and it's typically relevant where if you were bringing goods in and you wanted to do some additional manufacturing on them, then doing all of that within the designated area would mean you wouldn't then incur the additional VAT. But other than that, there are limited benefits, and you really have to look at specifically what the benefit would be for your organisation. Because the other thing is, it's not unreasonable to assume that a designated zone would have a higher fee, because they need to maintain that control. They need to maintain the customs boundary, and they need to maintain the enforcement and the restriction of goods and people in and out. Okay? Yes?
My question is from the same of our colleague here. We have a branch of foreign companies here in DMCC.
Okay.
And we are like a representative policy. We have several factories around the world.
Uh-huh.
We are supplying directly from these countries to other countries. Mm-hmm. We have just sales managers here in the UAE to be closer to our clients. Mm-hmm. So we are not invoicing anything. We are not purchasing uh-huh. anything outside UAE. Only deal uh-huh. our office rent and only local supplies to provide a place to our guys uh-huh. to sell. My question is, just to make sure, do we need to register for VAT mm-hmm. since we don't have any kind of revenues? We only issue debt to those.
Uh-huh.
We found in the expense we have here from our company in Australia, Brazil, mm-hmm. Netherlands.
So the first thing is, if you're not actively trading, it comes back to the earlier point, then you're not actually required to register for VAT. And if all of your business is outside the UAE, then you're not required to register for VAT. But if your expenses are over the voluntary registration limit of 187,000 and you might want to register, you then have to be mindful that what that means is you register as the entity. So all of the activities of the entity elsewhere in the world then come into view within the UAE. So to an extent, you have a choice to make. And then the other choice is, if all of your supplies are outside the scope of VAT, then how much VAT will you recover on your costs versus the cost of administration in terms of completing and submitting VAT returns? So I would look at it from both sides. Make an informed choice. If you're registered for VAT and you're making supplies, even if they're not here, then yes, you would get the VAT back on your costs. Okay. Yes.
Okay. So we are a commodity trader in the DMCC. We're purchasing everything from outside, from an overseas company. That company is actually sending the physical goods to our clients in the mainland.
Mm-hmm.
So we do need to invoice tax
uh-huh.
because our client is in the mainland. But do we only invoice invoice over the freight and the cost of the goods because we are not the importer, right?
Okay. So the mainland company is the importer of record? Yeah? So the mainland company that you're supplying the goods to is the importer of record?
Yeah.
Okay. So the mainland company is the one who actually does the import. So they would import subject to reverse charge. So then the question is, what supplies are you making? So if you were providing those goods to them directly, that would be plus VAT at 5%. But because they're coming from outside and coming in, then obviously they get to reverse charge them. But you said, do you charge them for the insurance and freight? So that's the bit that confuses me. So what's the difference between them being... So generally, I would expect the importer of record would pay the fully landed price of the goods. But what you said was slightly different, so...
Yes, so it was actually on your slide, on
okay.
The Q&A slide. So the purchases are received, then the physical goods are going directly from overseas to the mainland supplier.
Uh-huh.
And we are getting an invoice from the overseas supplier, and we are sending the invoice to the mainland
okay.
customer. And we are paying the freight, not
okay.
the insurance. So how do I invoice tax?
So who do you invoice just now and for what?
We invoice our mainland clients the cost of the goods
and the
freight. Do I put tax on that or not?
Yeah, so effectively if you're making that local supply to them, then you would have to charge them VAT, yes. Yeah. Okay. Yes.
If we buy the service, but this subcontractor, let's say, fails to register this invoice later on 28th day of the month, and he's supposed to submit this invoice for the authority. Is it important for us as a client whether he's registered this invoice, he submitted this invoice, when we want to claim our VAT
okay.
from the government?
Yeah. That's a good question. So just for everyone else's benefit, the question was, if you have a subcontractor, then if I paraphrase your question a little bit, but if you have a subcontractor and that subcontractor has given you an invoice, but for whatever reason they haven't properly declared it to the tax authority, then is the responsibility yours, or what happens and can you recover the VAT? So the first thing I would say is that it's not your responsibility to police your suppliers, okay? So you're not responsible for policing your suppliers from a VAT perspective. What I would do is encourage you, if you're registered for VAT, I would encourage you to encourage your suppliers to make sure that they're VAT compliant, but it's an encouragement, it's no more than that. And the only time it becomes more of an issue is where, if you have a supplier who's providing you with goods or services and you know they are well over the registration threshold and they haven't charged VAT, then you might start to wonder why, because that's not compliant. But going back to the question specifically, if you have an invoice from a supplier that is a valid VAT invoice, then you are entitled to claim back the VAT on that invoice, irrespective of what the supplier does with it. Because if the supplier hasn't declared it on their VAT return at the right time, that's their error, not yours. Okay? And so they would be the ones who would get a penalty for it. Now, something you said raised another question in my mind, because in order to account for VAT, effectively you have to look at all of the supplies that you've made and the invoices that you've issued, and you take the VAT value that's on all of those invoices. Okay, and that's the amount of output tax that you declare to the FTA. You then take the value of all of the VAT that you've paid and you have invoices for in that tax period, and you also declare that number. And then the difference between the two is the amount that you will either pay to the FTA or get a credit for. But what you don't have to do is give all of your invoices to the FTA. Your VAT return is just one summary document that, that has all of the summary of the total value of your cost, the total value of your sales, and the difference between the two. There are some other statistical numbers, but broadly that's what goes on your VAT return. So the invoices, you still need them, and you need to complete all of your documentation so that when, rather than if, but when you get an audit from the FTA, they will ask to see all of your invoices at that time, but you don't have to submit them with your VAT returns. Okay? Yes?
We are the member of DMCC trading companies. They have been jewelry sold.
Actually, I'm struggling to hear you for a little bit. Sorry, I'm actually choked with a cold, so my hearing's quite poor. It's my mistake, my hearing's just quite poor. Can I get you to speak up? Sorry.
We are the DMCC trading company.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, we assume it's a designated zone. Okay, all right. Okay, so let me, I actually wasn't being funny about designated zones, so let me touch on designated zones first and then I'll answer your question directly. Designated zones will have to be issued, at the moment there are no designated zones, let me put it that way, okay? There might be a couple of areas where you would assume they would qualify as a designated zone, but they don't actually exist yet. And the reason they don't exist, that in law, you will not have a designated zone until such time as the designated zone is issued in a cabinet decision. And there has been no cabinet decision giving a list of designated zones. So the concept exists, and there might be some areas where you think they're more likely to apply than others, but there are a great number of other areas where designated zones might have been requested, but they haven't yet been confirmed in the cabinet decision. So until the cabinet decision is out, there is no designated zone. So that's the first part on designated zones. But to answer your question directly, if you're trading in tea and the tea is in the designated zone and you're selling that tea to someone else inside the designated zone, then that's free of VAT. If you're selling that tea to someone outside the designated zone, then effectively they're importing it and you would have to charge VAT. Okay?
Hello.
Yes?
If a company in the UAE raises an advice to the company outside the UAE, mm-hmm. will the service is to dividend in the UAE? What is the impact of VAT on that? And also to provide the services, that company imports services from outside the UAE.
So which company imports the services from outside the UAE? The UAE company. Okay. All right, so I'm going to ask you another question. What type of services, because there are some special rule services, so I just want to make sure they don't qualify for that.
It's a client support service.
It's a?
Client support service.
Client support services, so general services.
General.
Not electronic, not telecommunications. Okay, so if I say, okay. So a bit of a general caveat here. So assuming it doesn't qualify under any of the special rules, then the general supply of services would say this. The services that you receive in order to fulfill your customer in the UK, so you receive a local service from someone else in the UAE, that's going to be plus VAT at 5%. The service that you provide to your customer, if your customer is in the UK, then the place of supply becomes the UK. So that's a zero-rated export of service to them, and they would have to reverse charge it in the UK. Yeah, so, but the place of supply, the place of service, you might be in the UAE, but you're providing services to a resident of the UK, so the place of supply shifts to the UK, which is where your customer is located. Okay? Okay.
Any consultancy fees on company invoices to any DMCC company subject to VAT?
any consulting?
Any consultancy or service license company refuses, then the invoice to the DMCC company is subject to VAT.
Yes, it would be subject to that because it would be the same as everything else. So from a free zone perspective, what's now being confirmed is that free zones to an extent are irrelevant from a VAT perspective. So a free zone company, whether you're either in or are receiving service from someone in a free zone company, is irrelevant for VAT. You have to then look at what the underlying transaction is. So if you drill that down, all that we're saying is that you have a consultant in the UAE providing services to another consultant, to someone else in the UAE, so that's going to be plus VAT.
It doesn't matter, it's a free zone.
Doesn't matter, it's free zone. Okay. Okay, hi. Okay, so if you're paying for software from the UK at 400,000, then effectively, remember the import of services rule? So you're importing those services into the UAE. So because you're doing that, they'll be subject to reverse charge. So that would mean that your 400,000 is already higher than the registration threshold of 375. So you would have to account, you would have to register for VAT in order just to account for your reverse charge supply. You then have to think about the supplies that you're then making. So that's the bit that I didn't quite hear. So you're making supplies where? So you're buying the software from the UK, and then what do you do with it?
We are using it for our own trading. We are not having any clients.
Okay, so but your own trading, and what is it that you're trading?
Electronically on the exchanges.
Okay, so if you're just simply trading on the exchange, then you still have to register in order to account for your import of services. You then have to look at the actual trading that you're doing, whether that's subject to VAT or not. It could be exempt, depending on the nature of the trading, or it could be taxable. So you then have to follow that through in order to work out what the treatment would be.
So that will be an additional cost, right,
in case
we are not able to charge?
So it would become an additional cost. If you if you're making exempt supplies, it would be an additional cost. Okay. Yes. Hi.
When you explain about holding value for shipping companies, you didn't say about diamond trading companies. There's an exception for diamond trading companies also?
No. Not an exception in terms of the general rules. There's the polishing. Well, there's not even an exception for the polishing because the service of polishing is still going to be subject to VAT at 5%. No. Okay, is that me? What? Oh, yeah, I'm being told time up. Okay. So shall we take just one more question? A final question. Who's lucky enough to get the final question? Oh, sorry, lots of hands.
Usually we import from that show anywhere. We have to pay the VAT on arrival or after 3 months.
So you would only pay the better way to do it is actually to do neither. The best way to do it is to have it reverse charge, in which case you don't have to pay VAT at all. Because the VAT would go straight onto your VAT return.
We need money from other companies outside of Dubai after 2018. If they will send for us, there is no VAT from Dubai. And there is invoices between us from Dubai to companies outside. Companies outside of Dubai, they need from us also payments.
Yes, so you would still. So if you're providing goods or services outside of Dubai, then that would be zero rated. Okay, so you are charging them VAT, but it's 0%. And if you were importing the diamonds, they would be subject to reverse charge. Okay? All right. Thank you very much. I hope that's been useful in giving you some insights to VAT and giving you some practical examples of how you can get ready. Okay, thank you.